Grasshopper definitions can become messy to organize and difficult to understand, as they can quickly go from a few components to hundreds of them. In this video, we will explore three reasons why your definitions should be clean and documented, and which methods we use here at ChipDiver to do so. The first reason is to make our definitions future-proof. This means that if 1 year from now we want to go back to the same definition, we will be able to understand in an instant what was created and how was created. So here at ChipDiver, we always have a list of legends that we use in our definitions, and we always keep them in the definition itself so that anybody that comes to it can understand how we organize our definitions. So for example, here we have parameters in black, which are the main parameters that will control the entire definition. Then we have basic groups, we have inputs and outputs, which we will check later in this video. Then we have exports. The exports are important, especially at ChipDiver, because with ChipDiver you can export files or extract information through data outputs to your cloud applications. Then we have the display, that is actually what will be seen by the user at the end in the viewer. Then we have local testing, that is basically components that we don't support at ChipDiver and that we want to delete before uploading. And finally, we have this tool that is ready to organize and in progress or to implement, that we will check also later. So down here, we have an example of how this looks like. And as you can see, you can clearly know which ones are our main parameters, the one that will be controlling the entire definition. Where are the components that are important for the display of our geometry? And where are the components that are relevant for exporting information or files from our definition? Additionally, in these modular groups, we have the white groups, which are ready to be used, but we also have the orange groups and the pink groups. So the orange groups are the ones that we defined that they are ready, but they still need to be organized. And the pink ones are the ones that need to be implemented. So we can, before even starting to create our definition, define what needs to be implemented by giving it a title, a description of what will happen in this group, but we can leave it there for preparation and to implement in the future, or to be implemented by somebody else. The second reason is to debug, edit, or extend our definition. So if we find any problems in our definition, or if we want to make any change in it, it can become a big challenge if our definition is a giant mess of wires. So if everything is connected with everything, and then we are not able to define where our extension or our bug is happening. That's why here at ChipDiver, we try to keep our definition modular, where there are small groups which are independent from each other, and we can easily reuse, move around, we can easily extend them, or find the bug and concentrate our efforts in that particular independent group. The reason why they are independent is because they are like small definitions inside the big one, where you have inputs in blue, outputs in green, and everything in between is not connecting to anything outside our white group. So everything in between has to always take information from the blue group and output information through the green group. And the third reason is to collaborate or to receive support. If you work in teams, the last thing that you want is your peers to be spending hours just trying to understand what you were intending with your definition. That's why it's very important to always title your modular groups and even give a description if it is necessary. In this way, anyone coming to check your definition will be able to understand what is the task of each of these groups. Additionally to that, each of the inputs and outputs should be clearly named so that we can understand which information is being stored. To name our inputs and outputs, we also have a method that is defined by the groups that are in our main parameters, in our black group. So here, each of these groups define a specific task. So for example, here we have a group that is just with parameters for the geometry itself. Here we have a group that is just for parameters that define materials. And a last one that define parameters for the downloads. So for example, in the first group, we have the geometry and the type of geometry that we want. So first of all, we defined the group name and then the task of this parameter. In the next one, for example, we have geometry and then the scale of this geometry. And we also have some hard-coded data. So we call hard-coded data everything that is stored in panels, because these panels are not accessible via ShapeDiver, so you are not able to change them through your cloud applications. Then the same happens with the other parameters, where you have, for example, material underscore color, material underscore type, download underscore 3D format, etc. And if we want to move this information into the other groups, we have also a method where we have a primitive in the icon format so that we know which kind of data we have. So for example, here we have a string, a text, here we have a boolean, here we have an integer, etc. Then we group this primitive and then we name the group with the specific data that is being stored. This primitive additionally has the wire format display to hidden, so that when we need to move this data into another group, we just need to copy this group and move it wherever is needed. So for example, we could move the material type, we could move the color, and then start creating here another group where we're gonna define the material of our geometry, for example. The same happens in the other subgroups, where in the outputs, we always have prepared a primitive named in a group and also with the wire hidden, so that we can then quickly reuse it in other parts of our definition. This template that we created here at ShapeDiver will be available down in the description, and you will be able to follow it easily through all the different notes that we have created around the definition. So you can start by reading the note, and then when you are done, you can double click on the jump and it will take you somewhere else in the definition where you can continue reading what are our recommendations regarding organizing your Grasshopper definitions. And this is all for today. I hope you learned something new. And if you want to know more about Grasshopper and ShapeDiver, don't forget to like this video and to subscribe and to visit our website at shapediver.com. And I will see you in the next one.